Hello, everybody. Paul Cheon here, and I am fresh back from Grand Prix Montreal. And of course, there was also Grand Prix Santiago and the Mox. And oh man, Standard might be in a rough spot right now. I'm not going to lie. We have Marvel winning all three of these tournaments. We had Marvel winning Grand Prix Santiago, Montreal, and Brock Parker won the Mox. So, are there any other decks that might be viable in Standard? Well, frankly, probably not. I mean, if you really want to win and maximize your chances of winning, you should probably just play Marvel until they ban the deck. I mean, this, you know what it is? It just feels like it's just the most powerful thing you could be doing in Standard. And if you play anything else, I feel like you're likely playing it just for the sake of being different. But it feels like, you know, Fairies way back in the day, and then Cobblade and Jund, Marvel feels like it's kind of on that level. Maybe not as strong as Cobblade, but it's the deck is definitely a little too good in my opinion. But this is a deck that's actually had a little bit of success. Sean McLaren and Anand Kari, I'm sorry if I butchered your last name, I'm sorry. but both of them piloted Black-Green Delirium Constrictor to a top 8 and top 16 finish at the Grand Prix. So, I think you guys are getting a little bit tired of probably watching Marvel, so this is a different deck, that you can play that might give you a chance against the Marvel Menace. Granted, if your opponents still just go turn 4 Ulamog, there's not a lot you can do, but if they don't, then you might actually have a chance. So let's take a look at this deck. We have, of course, our mana base, bunch of forests and swamps. If you notice, there's less swamps in this deck than the traditional Delirium lists, and that's because this deck does not play Grasp of Darkness. So having a turn 2 Grasp of Darkness is not as important. We have 3 copies of Fatal Push for cheap interaction against all the low drops in the format. Very, very important for cards like Heart of Kirin, Crypt Breaker, etc. Then we have our Traverse the Overworld, gets us land in the early game, and then gets us threats in the late game. Then we have our 2 mana creatures. We have Winding Constrictor. Lots of good synergies with that in Rishkar, Tireless Tracker, Verdus Gearhulk, and Ballista. 4 copies of Grim Flayer, and now this is a 2-drop that a lot of people opt to play different copies of. If you're on Energy, you can play Long Tusk Cub or Glintsleeve Siphoner. If you like Sylvan Advocate, you can play that. But we're looking to play a Delirium deck, so we're playing Grim Flayer here. Then we have 4 copies of Dissenter's Deliverance. Now, this is kind of the tech card that Sean McLaren played with at the Pro Tour. He had 3 copies of this in the main at the Pro Tour, and then upped it to the full 4 at the Grand Prix. And, well, we all know why. This allows you to destroy an Aetherworks Marvel after it's resolved. And the thing is, if Marvel does not hit Ulamog on the first spin, you can get it with the Dissenter's Deliverance. And you know, the chances of hitting an Ulamog are somewhere along the lines of 30-35%, depending on whether or not you've drawn one. So it's kind of a decent gamble, I guess. You know, if you're playing Black-Green, this is probably the best main deck card you can have against them. That's a little flexible against a lot of other decks. It gives your main deck answers to Torrential Gearhulk, which is Blue-Red Control being one of the more popular decks in the format, as it matches up reasonably well against Marvel. And against Mardu Vehicles, it's also a great card, as one of the few ways you can... Well, one of the ways you can die is to Aethersphere Harvesters and Heart of Kirin's. So this gives you, because you don't have Grasp of Darkness to deal with Heart of Kirin, but if you're main decking the Dissenter's Deliverance, you can still get those pesky vehicles. On top of that, the most important part, it's got cycling, right? This deck doesn't have a whole lot of instants, and this allows you to put an instant immediately into your graveyard to help you get Delirium. So, you know, you have your Deliverances and Fatal Pushes as instants, Traverses, Never to Return to Sorceries, we have Artifact Creature, and ways to put lands into our yard as well. Moving into our 3 mana slot, now this is a spot where things change. We have the full 4 Tireless Trackers in the main deck. Sean McLaren opted to play 3 Trackers and 1 Rishkar, and Anand chose to play 4 Trackers and 1 Rishkar, and well, I'm a sucker for this card. I think there's going to be a lot of Marvel, and I think Tracker is a little better in that matchup, so I'm opting to play the full 4 here. This does prevent you from getting those crazy draws where you go turn 2 threat into turn 3 Rishkar, but do like the Trackers, and Anand, again, did quite well with this deck as well. Then we have 4 copies of Nissa, Voice of Zendikar, and 2 copies of Liliana. And again, at the Pro Tour, Sean played 3 Nissas and 1 Liliana. I think he opted to up it to two Liliana as Zombies is now a real deck, and Liliana is one of the best threats that you can have against Zombies in the main deck. You can even go up to three if you wanted, if you expected a lot of Zombies, but my suspicion is Zombies is not going to be all that popular. Four copies of Nissa, Voice of Zendikar, another card that allows you to... another card that has good synergy with Winding Constrictor, and just a threat on its own, and it's quite, having access to these Planeswalkers, pretty strong against control decks, because blue-red control has a lot of difficulty dealing with Planeswalkers that have resolved. So you're just trying to overload your control opponents with powerful 3-mana cards that all need to be countered. Couple of copies of Never to Return for large creatures and Planeswalkers. Also opting to play the Never to Return instead of Ruinous Path, as Return allows you to get rid of cards like Scrap Heap Scrounger and Dread Wanderer. Then we have one copy of Kalidus as a bullet for Traverse the Uvenwald against Zombies decks. And we have one copy of Verdurous Gearhulk. You can play two of this, but I think Sean and Anon opted to kind of keep their deck more streamlined so you can play a little less lands. And wow, it's crazy. This deck used to start with four Verdurous Gearhulks, and now you're down to one. You are playing four copies of Traverse the Uvenwald, so I can see shaving some number of this. And it's kind of interesting that after the format's kind of shifted, we're now down to only one copy of Verdurous Gearhulk in the main. All right, let's go into the sideboard here. We have two copies of Yeheni's Expertise. This card is specifically for Zombies. You can play against, if you ever run into a white weenie deck, you can board that in there as well. But this exists because you have a lot of 1-for-1 removal spells, but sometimes the zombie decks, they're really, really good at going wide. And this is kind of the card that allows you to kind of beat them. We have one copy of Ish Kana, which again, against creature decks, it's an excellent card against Mardu vehicles as well. It's probably one of your best bullets to search for in that matchup. Now, one card in the sideboard you're not going to see that you might expect, and it's certainly a consideration, is one copy of Manglehorn. It's a card you can traverse for against decks like Marvel, where sometimes they have a Marvel they miss, and you have a traverse for Manglehorn. So I don't think it's totally unreasonable to play one in the sideboard, but I think the idea is you're playing four copies of Dissenter's Deliverance in the main, so you don't really need more. If you did play a Manglehorn, you effectively increase the number of shatter effects to 9. So again, it's certainly a possibility. You can play that if you want to. We have two copies of Obnixilus Reignited for the grindy matchups. We have two copies of Never to Return, again, for grindy matchups. For example, the Mirror, I think this card is quite strong. Two copies of Gonti, again, for the slower matchups. So a lot of cards for slow matchups because, game one, your curve is really, really low. And then after sideboard, you're trying to go higher up the curve with Obnixiluses and Gontis. Then we have cards against Control and Marvel. We have four copies of Transgress the Mind and two copies of Dispossess. I imagine all of those go in against those decks. Dispossess, of course, you can name Aetherworks Marvel. And against Blue-Red Control, you can also name Torrential Gearhulk. So this is kind of the deck. There are other considerations that I wanted that I thought about, but these guys have had a lot of success with this deck, so I wanted to just kind of more or less copy their list. Sean McLaren, for example, played a Sky Sovereign in his sideboard, and another card you could consider is a Distended Mindbender, but less 3-mana creatures in this deck because you have Nissa, Voice of Zendikar, and Liliana as your 3-drop, so no Mindbender here. So we're going to try this. It's not Marvel, but maybe it's the next best thing. All right, welcome everybody to the first round, and we are on the play, and I'm going to keep this. We've got two lands. We have a Traverse, which I'm going to use to get Swamp, as we have Never to Return. Next turn, we can play either the Constrictor or the Grim Flayer. Game Trail. I think I want to play the Grim Flayer here, as I kind of want to... I kind of want to smooth out my draws here. Oh! I guess that's one thing. I mean, I guess my opponent could have had a Magma Spray. This is... nobody plays this card anymore. Shock. Little surprise, not gonna lie. It's a good card, but it's largely been replaced by Magma Spray because the Exile Clause is very, very relevant. All right. We were it was just sandbagging. I mean, we wanted the winding constrictor to resolve. So yeah, my opponent has the one shelter thicket. I wonder if this is Marvel. This fatal push is not looking especially good though. So what do I want to draw here? I guess a land. Oh. Big Ronus. Alright, I guess. Hey, look. 4 mana Triskelion, not terrible, right? That's basically all it was. But we're definitely not putting on the most pressure here. That is a lot of pressure. All right. We are taking 9 damage this turn. Wow. So I probably need to kill the Lothnu Hellion here. I also have access to like sacrifice Walking Ballista Fatal Push or something. But yeah, okay. Oh no, is this a blossoming defense too? Jeez. All right. Well. Yeah, I mean, I guess our play is Walking Ballista, sacrifice Fatal Push. Yeah, and like if my opponent plays like a Bristling Hydra here, for example, we can still kill it with the energy trigger on the stack. But we're not going to now. Yeah, I mean, this prevents the Ronus from attacking, so I think I need to do this, but we're certainly not in a good spot here. If my opponent has another Blossoming Defense, we die. Okay. That's not that bad. Like, if my opponent's turn was play Harness Lightning there, can't be too sad. I guess we just make a 2-2. It seems better than just cycling a Dissenter's Deliverance. You can shock my zombie. Glorybringer? That would suck. Nope, there's the Hellion. Another target creature gets... Okay, so I'm going to just chump block the Ronus here. My opponent can't pump the Hellion. Deal 6 damage to me. And I need to find a way to get this off the board. Ah, man. We can't, like... We don't have the ability to go tracker, land, cycle, clue. Trying to see if there's anything else I can do. No. All right. I think we're dead. Energy beatdown's too strong. Yeah. All right. Good beats. All right. So I think we're going to be taking these one out. Sorry, these dissenters' deliverances out. Let's bring some never to returns in. These do just kill a creature. Expertise doesn't seem especially good. Gonti seems okay because Death Touch is pretty strong. Maybe Ishkana. Walking Ballista is not especially good at... Also, we saw nothing to Fatal Push really, but I think that was more of an anomaly than anything. Like, they have to have like Long Tusk Cubs and stuff because they had energy. So I imagine the Fatal Pushes will be relevant. Actually, Ishkana is probably mediocre. I mean, it's like a decent blocker, but the reach doesn't matter, right? And I don't think we're shrinking anything too relevant here. All right, we'll try this. Maybe the Ishkana should be in there. Fatal Push Ballista. I mean, this is effectively a 5-land hand, but we do have a Fatal Push for something early. Alright, I believe in my deck. I'll hold on to the Traverse, though. Yeah, like, they have to have, like, Greenbelt Rampagers and stuff. But that's the thing. Shaman Clarence's list is heavily tuned to be able to beat like the top decks in the format, but I think it's, you know, certainly worse against these energy decks where this is where you really miss a card like Grasp of Darkness. I'm not saying what Sean did is incorrect. I think what Sean did is where you want to be, but we are definitely getting punished elsewhere. Was probably getting Harness Lightning or something. Oh, still have this in, huh? I could have like Fatal Pushed my Walking Ballista on the stack, deal 1 damage to my opponent, but that's only 3 types in the yard. Maybe these Fatal Pushes aren't very good. I don't know. All right, incoming Lothnew Hellions. Yeah. Man, this deck just has the ability to deal so much damage so quickly. Like, 2-for-1-ing myself to kill Lothnew Hellion just seems so bad. And especially if my opponent has... Yeah, I'm just going to take it. It's another Winding Constrictor. Does that do anything? I think my plan next turn is to block Ronus with Ballista and then use Fatal Push on the Lothnew Hellion. But my opponent could have a Blossoming Defense. And if that's the case, then I want to have double Fatal Push up. I could choose to get a Swamp with Traverse. I mean, again, I'm pretty far away from Delirium. So, if I get a Swamp with Traverse, I can still play Land Constrictor. This is worse against Tireless Tracker. Like, if I draw Tireless Tracker. But gives me a little bit of Blossoming Defense protection. Yeah, all their creatures are just kind of a little bit bigger than ours because, again, we're also just playing one copy of Verdor Scare Hulk. We now have Delirium, so if we draw another Traverse, we can play something. We can go fetch something nice. Okay, that's a decent sign. Play a creature I can push. Nope. Yep, we're on the hope our opponent has nothing planned. Okay, they have something planned. And yeah, the Fatal Push cannot get the Ronus as it is indestructible. Yeah, basically, I mean, I just don't want Lothnu Hellions. Like it. Actually, I mean, I guess if my opponent plays like a Bristling Hydra or something, that's also bad. Wow, my opponent whiffed. We have a chance, folks. Okay, that's a threat. Keeping the land in hand because of a potential tireless tracker off the top. Yeah, one of the main reasons for playing Ballista here, again, it's not especially impressive in this matchup, but hey, helps us get Delirium, and it's still an early drop. Okay, this is a two-turn clock. We get to find some action here. Down in the yard. All right, can play out of land here now. As we have one in reserve. So what does my opponent have in hand? I feel like one of the cards is probably Blossoming Defense. I mean, it could also be Shock, right? I'm just trying to piece together what potential cards my opponent can have. It could also be a second Ronus. Because my opponent does have a bunch of cards in hand. So I'm thinking Shock, Ronus, something along those lines. Maybe a bunch of lands, I don't know. All right, so how am I sideboarding now? So again, my opponent just played 0 2 mana creatures in both games. Do I just cut these? Do I want Transgress the Mind? I mean, my opponent's like pressuring my life total though. So it doesn't seem especially good. Maybe I play the Ishkana because it does do a good job of kind of blocking all the things. Liliana doesn't really stop much. I mean, I can try just like three transgresses here. Maybe that's better than the fatal pushes. Or two transgress, I guess. I mean, the thing is, you would kind of normally expect this to be some kind of Long Tusk Cub, Voltaic Brawler, Greenbelt Rampager deck. But perhaps my opponent's just trying to go higher up the curve with Ronus, Bristling Hydras, and what have you. In which case, the fatal pushes aren't quite as good. One land, can't keep. Keep that. Land, sorcery, three land. I'm gonna bottom that. I don't think I want that right now. Attune. Turn one Aether Hub usually means attune. Okay, so I have the option of traverse the Ulvenwalding for a swamp here instead of just leading out with Evolving Wilds. Yeah, I think that's actually better. So I'm already sequencing out my next few turns. I'm gonna go turn two Transgress, turn three Nissa, turn four Tracker Evolving Wilds. Is my opponent finally playing a two drop? Yeah, of course. I mean, I guess I had to assume that they had this, but I don't know. Maybe they sideboarded it out. God, this could literally be just a fatal push. So this is what we know about. All right. And they have an invigorated rampage so they can get the Nissa. Oh man, this is rough. This is like currently a dead card. You know what people call this? People call this maximum punishment. Maximum punishment. I mean, granted, we got a lot through Hellion, so the first one wasn't bad, but again, I would have much rather my opponent have a Hellion on board instead of this Long Tusk Cub that's currently getting out of hand. What is this? Okay. I imagine they're both going to be attacking the Nissa. No, wait, what? Oh, okay. This prevents my opponent from making energy. This makes my opponent eat up the energy. They do have an invigorated rampage, so they can't threaten to end the game. Man, am I gonna lose to invigorated rampage? It's looking very likely that that's the case. See, my opponent can make a four-powered Long Tusk Cub. If I choose to just chump block with a plant, my opponent has 8 power plus the 4 from the rampage, so that's 12 power. Whew. But it feels so bad to just block with a Tireless Tracker. But then we just die to like any shock effect. So again, 4, 8, 12, minus 1. So we go down to 2. And if I block Tracker here, my opponent just pumps. And if I put a plant here, they also pump. So then that goes 6, 5 damage plus... Not... Alright, I'll just... Alright, I go to 2. I think this gives me the best chance of winning. I mean, obviously we're not in a good spot right now, but I think this gives us the best chance of winning. Oh. Never mind. Yeah. Like, I just had to kind of hope to survive that turn. But, I mean, kind of deserve it, I guess. I mean, we had to transgress the mind in our hand, and we certainly could have kept the fatal pushes in, although this is the first time we saw a card for that fatal push.